Hey everyone, I was just, nothing. So 2 months ago, I uploaded a Q&A video. And there's been some questions. 8 people asked me stuff. Some people asked me dumb stuff. Some people asked me really dumb stuff. But nonetheless, there's some good content here, especially gaming-wise. And today, I was gonna respond to these absurd questions. I'm gonna be doing them in order that they were asked, at least I'm gonna try, and we're just gonna see what happens. Jack28 asks, what are you collecting now? You used to collect Skylanders, Star Wars helmets, certain game statues, so curious, anything new? So there's nothing new that I'm collecting. In fact, those Star Wars helmets, I sold them all. I have the intention to move in the future, and I don't want to lug around too much stuff. But most importantly, I was looking at them and thinking to myself, why do I have this? I'm not even that big of a Star Wars fan. And I actually found a store that bought the entire collection that I owned. I was able to get my new phone from it. So that was good riddance. And quite a load off my mind, actually. I never know why I started it. I mean, I know why I started it. But yeah, so that's gone. And I try to stay more contained with my collecting. Video games is my biggest passion, and I wanted to focus more on video game collecting. I haven't bought a lot of retro stuff in the past couple of years. And there's reasons. You gotta look towards the future, but that's where I want to go back to. Retro gaming, retro game collecting, that's collecting wise my biggest passion. I have cards as well, collector cards, 3x3 eyes, Pokemon, Dragon Ball. I actually sold 2 of my original base one Charizards to fund my tattoo. I feel less attached to things. I'm trying to really focus my collecting. And I don't want to collect other stuff or be stuck with other things. Gaming is just where I want to keep it at. Trezina asks, this is a gaming channel and you, like many of the people watching, have valuable games and collector's items and things that have sentimental value and all that. So with that said, if your apartment caught fire, what would you go in and try to save if you could? I like this question though. I don't know if it's morbid or not. I often think if my apartment would caught fire, what would I save? I instantly go to, first of all, everything that's alive. So my cats, you know, my childhood plush. I have a music box that is in the other room right now. That is from my childhood. Things that matter to me for my girlfriend, a personal project I'm working on. But you're asking gaming wise, what is the gaming object that I would save from my apartment? And this is interesting. And it's hard to decide on the spot because I didn't prepare any of these answers. I have down here, actually, in here, my complete inbox Bionic Commando for the original NES. You don't find Bionic Commando, the PAL version, a lot already. It's not factory sealed, but it's staying next to my Totally Red, which is factory sealed, and my Solar Jetman, which is factory sealed, so I definitely would pick those up. But the Bionic Commando one, I have never seen one that is in as perfect a condition as mine, and that is definitely what I'm instantly thinking of. I'm also instantly thinking of saving button titles. I could just pick it up online, I don't know. But I have my GameCube games there behind the camera in a shelf hanging on the wall. And the top 3 from there are like button, in a row, is Button Kaitos, Skies of Arcadia, and Tales of Symphonia. They're some of the greatest games ever made and legit ridiculously expensive today. So I would grab those 3 as well. So like, I'm sitting here, it's catching fire. I can grab my Bionic Commando, I run towards the door, grabbing Button Kaitos, Skies of Arcadia, Tales of Symphonia on my way out. I might run quickly to my bedroom and get my Xenoblade Chronicles 2
Special Edition, which has the incredible art book, which I have not even looked at yet because I'm still playing the game right now, so I didn't look at it yet. So there's a bunch of things here and there, and that's like quickly on my mind right now. There's also my figure of Death and Majora's Mask that are behind me that are gaming related. My girlfriend got me that one. It has insane value to me personally for what it represents, why she gave that to me. On top of that, the Skull Kid. But at this point, it's ridiculous in price. So I would grab those, grab that, and I think that my hands are full. And by then I'm outside, everything is burning down, my cats are safe, and then I'll probably be like, crap, I kind of forgot to pick up that game. But on the spot, right now, those are the ones that I came up with. And that's a realistic situation. I don't have an hour to think about the answer. It's on the spot, everything is burning, grab what I can. Midnight Owl asks, how many pairs of socks with holes in them do you own? I have 0 pairs of socks with holes in them. I am wearing one sock right now, which is the only individual sock I have with a hole in it. Because when I tore off the label, it created a hole in them. That is all. One individual sock has an actual hole in it.
Gaming With Me asks, what would you do for a 1 million subscriber special? I mean, at that point, you'd have to do some crazy special video that you would only do if you cross a major amount like that.
This is the one question that I actually have given thought since he posted it. I can't even gain one sub this year. It's ridiculous. My sub count has been stagnating for years and years and years. This year I tried to do a video every week, tried to break free. It hasn't worked. I made a Switch Pro video, gained 20 subs from that. I lost like 10 from them again. I'm just dying. But if by some happenstance I would actually get to 1 million subs, let's be real, that means you're making good money off your videos and I could do something big. The one thing that actually came to mind for me is make a live podcast episode. So, some of you might know, I'm on the podcast with Gaming With Me, Mr. T, The Insane Game Freak, Clock Dead, and Terminator Juice. And we have a podcast every Monday. I mean, who's on lately? Everybody has busy schedules, things shift around, but general, we're the 6 members of this podcast. And if I would have 1 million subs, I feel I would probably have the budget to go to America to pay for everybody to get to one spot and do like maybe a round table setup with cameras aimed at everybody and do a live podcast. Now, it's 1 million subscriber special. We probably talk about some of the history of our channel, but most likely the games we love the most. I want to talk about, no, not just news topics, but talk about video games I think we love and do that in like a live setting. I feel for 1 million special, that's pretty cool. Then you get more people, you know. If I have 1 million subs, I mean, everybody would get traction from that as well. And I feel that's a great way to celebrate 1 million subscriber special by just sharing it with my friends and just having fun talking about video games and having some beers at the same time.
Mr. Norbert 1994 asks, will you ever going to talk more about the horrors and frustrations of PAL Nescor?
I mentioned my Beyond the Commando PAL exclusive version just now. I used to make several videos regularly about PAL versions of video games. I had stories about Ninja Gaiden, which was Shadow Warriors over here, but then you had a separate European version where Ryu Hayabusa didn't have a mask on, and then they made Shadow Warriors. That was a whole thing. And I used to talk about factory sealed games and regional differences, and that is my favorite thing in retro collecting, because I guess because I grew up here, I don't know, it's just different, and I like the differences of PAL. I like the way that stuff works and box variations and stuff, and it is without a doubt a topic I want to get back into. I want to try to do more retro stuff while staying on news, on current day topics and everything, but I definitely want to put more retro back in my videos.
Back in the day, hits with the serious stuff, didn't you say you were in the process of trying to move to the States? If that happens, what are some of the things that you really look forward to doing once you become a US citizen? Are you planning on getting any more tattoos? What is the one song or band that would fall into your guilty pleasure category?
There's a bunch of questions there. I'm gonna start with the easiest ones. A guilty pleasure song. Nothing really specifically comes to mind, but I under my bed I have a box with CD singles that I used to collect. And when I was, you know, ever since I was a little kid, with my first allowance, I bought one of my the first CDs I bought were Ace of Base, It's a Beautiful Life, and All for One, When I Swear, and I Swear, and I'm fairly certain over the years, I bought like, I have about 100 CD singles, you know, of individual bands, individual songs. And I'm fairly certain a bunch of those at this point would be my guilty pleasures. It's like, why am I listening to this? Why do I own this? I've thought this several times, but I don't know. I just like the sounds of certain of those songs. I can't give any specifics, you know, like maybe the ones I just mentioned would count. I own the single Barbie Girl, for example. Right now, I'm like, why? And when I hear it being parodied, I think to myself, why? Why do I own this? And there's probably a bunch more like that that would qualify as guilty pleasures, I feel. When it comes to metal, I don't have guilty pleasures. I do. There's so much music in the world. There's so much metal. I'm discovering new metal every day through Atmospheric Black Metal, the channel on YouTube, for example. There's so much stuff, and I just don't have time, in a way, to listen to music I shouldn't be listening to. So there you go. When it comes to tattoos, there's a bunch of tattoos I still want, without a doubt. As of now, I have 3 tattoos. I have a logo on my arm that represents my brothers. I have the Summoning Metal Band logo on my back. And the tattoo I got in the beginning of this year, a spider with a whale on my arm. There's a few things specifically I always know I wanted and I still want. I want a Reaper in some way, shape, or form on my body. There's a logo of my favorite anime that I want, Serial Experiments Lane, and I always imagined it going below the logo I designed for my brother, because that way you have the shapes that are kind of together, and in my mind that just looks good. There's another tattoo I plan on getting, which is like a coffin with a scenery in it. I probably won't get a lot of massive ones. Still, one on my arm is really huge. It's probably going to be smaller ones from now on. I don't know, but there's one I still want. It might be reasonably big. I want, and I've always wanted this, I just got to find a way to make it work. The winglet from Kallus, from Bodengeidos, on my left shoulder blade. And I want it open, extended, so it's probably going to continue a bit on my arm. I don't know how to design it yet or how to see it. It's in the far future, that, because it's a big one. And I don't know exactly how to do it yet, but I know for a fact that I want that. So, Bodengeidos is my favorite video game of all time. And Kallus, he's the main character. And in this world, people have wings. But Kallus only has one wing. But because Kallus only has one wing, he has a winglet that was designed for him, which is a mechanical wing, and I absolutely love the design of this wing, and I want it on my shoulder blade, the way where he would have it, and then open, because I just love the design of this. I have a bunch of ideas still, so without a doubt, I'm definitely getting more tattoos. I love tattoos. I think tattoos look amazingly cool. Now, there are spots where I, without a doubt, will never get a tattoo. I like working in the hotel business. I like working in jobs where you have to be presentable. Unfortunately, that is the world we live in. I will never get a tattoo on my knuckles, for example. Most likely never on my hands, never on my feet. I will never get anything on my face or on my neck. My personal rule when it comes to tattoos is you have to be able to wear a suit. That's just the world we live in. That's how I personally feel about it. But that's also specifically because of career choices that I have or things for the future that I want for myself. You know, I can't want in the future to maybe build up my own hotel, my own business like that, and I meet with important clients while having like tattoos on my knuckles. That's just something that I personally would never do. But there's without a doubt more tattoos coming. I'm looking forward to it. There's specific artists that I've seen where I'm like, man, I would love a tattoo from this artist without knowing what kind of idea from that I have. For example, my girlfriend showed me a tattoo artist that her friend likes, and I saw this, I'm like, man, I would love to fucking get something from this person, you know, but I have no idea what. So definitely 100% yeah, more tattoos are coming. This is something I think is really cool. It looks cool on dudes, it looks cool on chicks. I like seeing tattoos, it's just who I am. And what do I look forward to doing once I become a US citizen? So I love to travel. I really love to travel. I've been kind of semi over the world, you know, especially in Europe. I've seen everything. I've seen Germany, Belgium, the Netherlands. I've seen Ireland. I almost saw Scotland until crap hit the fan like a year ago. I've been to Switzerland. I've been in Austria. I've been to America now a few times. High up on my list are Scotland. I want to make that work. And Japan and Iceland. They're my top three. But there are a lot of things I would like to see in the United States. Now, I grew up with American television, American TV shows, and there's a bunch of stuff I always see or wanted to do. I would first of all love to actually have been in every single state in the United States. I don't know why, it is something I have in my head. I've seen quite a few already. Even if I just drive through them, I will count it, you know? And I've actually seen a few already. I think I've been in Massachusetts. I want to say I've been in New Hampshire. I've been in New York. Rhode Island. So I've seen quite a few states already. And there's more I want to see. Specific spots that have always been at the top of my list are Yosemite Park and Yellowstone Park. I like nature and that kind of stuff. I would love to see Oregon. Like, all of this is nature related. Oregon especially, I feel, is one of the most beautiful states there is. We have Las Vegas. I know it's a lot of stuff that I just know from TV that I want to experience. Like Las Vegas, I want to walk on the strip, you know. I don't need to spend $1 million in a casino, but I want to be in that strip. I want to be in a casino. It's something I want to experience. And that's just from the top of my head. There's a bunch more. I want to experience the theme parks like Disney in America. I've heard the ones here are quite jack. The Universal Studios. I want to see Florida, you know, like California. I would like to see Miami. Just a lot of things from TV that I want to see. And there's a bunch of things I forget. And I want to try a lot of you guys' weird food and experience like arcade halls and retro stores, which are ridiculous in America how many there are. Something I'm legit planning in my head, kinda, that you have a lot in the United States that you don't really have over here. We have flea markets over here. But in the United States, you have actual garage sales, and those are like gold mines to find retro games. And that is without a doubt high up on my list to make a habit to regularly go to garage sales and hunt for video games. And that's something that I would put in my videos and I would make videos about. No, without a doubt. And I look forward to those kinds of things. A big thing, this is going to become a big segment. A big thing I'm also looking forward to once I would be a US citizen is holidays. We don't have Thanksgiving over here. And that always seemed like a really cool family holiday, just get together. I do that here with my family for Christmas, for example. We get together, we eat, we laugh, we talk. And I like that kind of stuff. And I want to just be able to experience the actual full glory of Halloween. Haunted houses, decorations, horror things on TV. It's just stuff you do not have over here. Not to that degree. And I've experienced true Halloween the first time I went to the United States. And it just doesn't compare to what we have over here. Gaming With Me asks another question. What's the one system you wish you could have for the entire library of? There's two answers that come to mind. And my first answer is probably the one I would go with. So my second answer would be the GameCube. I like the GameCube. It's one of my favorite systems. I like collecting for the GameCube. But if I now could make a wish and I would own the entire library of a console, it would without a doubt be the NES.
This may be right here.
Because the NES is really hard to collect for. It's one of the hardest to collect for because of artificial inflation, because of video game YouTubers making videos, and then the prices just keep going up. It is just simply one of the most expensive systems to collect for. Specifically with some of the PAL exclusives, I still wanna hunt down. It's just way too expensive. And I feel I get more joy out of the NES in a way, which is why it's my favorite console. With the GameCube, if I would have the entire library, I can finally play this game, I can finally play this game. But with the NES, if I would have the whole library, I have so much fun just randomly playing a game and then trying another one and then trying another one. And I just don't have that same fun with the GameCube. And obviously I want to finish off these games, but it's more fun to just play a bunch of games and I just get more joy out of it. I also have zero nostalgic affection when I look at a GameCube game, compared to how I feel when I look at a NES game, when I hold it, when you have the sound of the game sliding in the dust sleeve protector, you know, and it's just on a whole other level for me, the original NES. And the final question is from Mr. T. Why do you have such extreme takes? I love this question. So on the podcast that I'm on, I'm usually the one that has crazy takes and people get all up and about because of the things I have to say. I love Super Mario Sunshine. It's a great game. I absolutely hate Metroid Prime 2 Echoes. It's an awful game. I made a whole 30-minute video about going into the history of why I hate this game. Gameplay-wise, things personal to me, it's a whole reason and I showcase it. And people don't like that. Xenoblade Chronicles X, the game that was advertised as this amazing game, and you can fly with these amazing mechs through these country landscapes, and out of the 12 chapters, I'm in chapter 9 and my thing still can't go and fly at the end of the game. It's a boring open world. So he means things like that. People don't like it when I say things like that. I think Xenoblade Chronicles 2 is the vastly superior game to Xenoblade Chronicles X, for example. I think Skyward Sword, The Legend of Zelda, is trash. When it comes to video games, it's a great game. But if you're taking into account the Zelda games, it's a bad Zelda game. The imprisoned fee, all the stupid stuff, the character design, I hate it and stuff. I can't stand this game. When they announced Skyward Sword, they said, like, I'm not gonna quit until I make a game that rivals Ocarina of Time when it comes to freedom and what you can do in the game. And they made the segmented garbage. It was disappointing from what they promised and stuff. It does have incredible dungeons. But yeah, people do not like my opinions. It's not like I'm saying things like, wait for my top 10 video games of the year. I might even say things like, I don't think Metroid Dread is top 3. If you think that's a crazy opinion, then sue me!
I don't think that's a crazy take. Is it?
But I just know what I like. I know what I like. If I see a trailer of a video game, I know if I'm gonna like it or not. If I play a game, I know what I'm looking for in a game. I know what I want to be there, so I know very precisely what I like and do not like in video games. I am just very vocal about my takes, and because I know exactly what I like, I'm very precise in what I'm saying, and I don't know, I just don't like the same things most people like. Maybe it's the European in me. I don't know, we can be pretty weird. So there you have it. That was the last question asked. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I hope you got some laughs out of this, and that these answers were satisfying to you. I had a lot of fun answering these. I like that the gaming ones, some caught me off guard and it made me think about some stuff in a different way. If you want more content from me in the future, I'm pretty sure eventually I'll do another Q&A, so stay tuned if you want to ask me more stuff. You can ask me stuff in this video comment section of this video right here, and I'll answer it right in the comment section. There's gonna be a lot more video game content coming in the future. I mentioned it before, I wanna do video game hunting kind of stuff. I do gameplay, I do top 10s, I do reactions. Next year, gaming-wise, is gonna be crazy, so stick around. Subscribe to my channel if you wanna see where this channel is gonna head when it comes to all that craziness. I love video games, I love collecting video games, and I'm really glad that this year specifically I've been able to show that a lot more when it comes to my videos. Thank you all for watching. Share this video with those you think might like it. Share those videos with those you think that should know the craziness that are my gaming opinions. Subscribe, like, and stay real.